وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
I really want to finish it. I don't know if I can honestly finish it. So I can say things, but they're just going to be half-baked. And it's not giving the point justice. And I think this topic, this particular part, deserves haqq. So let's not, every point we stand over proper details. And if we don't finish it, then we have to somehow organize another time for the remaining parts. Instead of doing it fast, quickly. Ma ra'yukum? Yeah? So we do it in proper details now. Wherever Allah, the time finishes, قَدَرَ اللَّهُ مَا شَاءَ فَعَلْ. We'll set another time. Yeah, okay. But right now we're not in a time, you know, there's shubhats are open regarding Sahih Bukhari's authenticity, whether Bukhari wrote it, وَمَا إِلَى ذَلِكَ. So this needs to be responded to in an ilmi perspective, of course. So please, I want you to all not be upset if I stop somewhere halfway, okay? Because I'm going to give each. I think this is more important than what we took before. Even though what we took before is very important, but knowing this book is vital. Okay, let's carry on, inshallah ta'ala. First, I want to say, inshallah ta'ala, Al-Imam al-Bukhari al-Sahih is the most authentic book any human being has ever written. So look what I said. What did I say? It's the most authentic book any human being has ever written. Human written. That's a powerful statement. Any religion, any nation that came before us, they don't have anything like Bukhari. Are you with me, brothers? And what we can say now, Bukhari is more authentic today than some of the scriptures that some people are holding on to. Are you with me? This is La Buddha. فَلِذَلِكَ الْعَرَاقِي when he said, وَأَوَّلُ مَنْ صَنَّفَ فِي الصَّحِيحِ مُحَمَّدٌ وَخُصَّ بِالتَّرْجِيحِ وَمُسْلِمٌ بَعْدُ وَبَعْضُ غَرْبِ مَعْ أَبِي عَلِيٍّ فَضَّلُوا ذَلُوا نَفَعْ ولم يعماه ولكن قلما عند ابن الأخرم قد فاتهما ورد لكن قال يحيى البر. The first person who wrote an authentic book was who? Al-Imam al-Bukhari. You have to all understand that the books were written before Bukhari. No one conditioned authenticity. We're going to come into that later, inshallah ta'ala. Are you with me, brothers? Bukhari is the first to say, I am going to write an authentic Are you with me, brothers? That's one point I want everybody to understand. Lakin, our chapter later, which is called Al-Mufadalatu Bayna Sahihayn, we're going to compare the two Sahihs. Okay? I don't want to go too much into it now. Lakin, there were some people who gave precedence to Muslim over Bukhari. What's the response to that? We'll speak about it, inshallah. Okay, brothers? But I want to now say a point as a second introduction. Like the first introduction was Bukhari is the most authentic book. And I will prove that inshallah ta'ala. Number two. Why these six books? Kutub Sita that we hear. Where did this come from? Who did this? Why did they coin six books? The six mothers. Where? Quickly write this beneficial information. First of all, who's meant by the six books? Number one is Al-Bukhari. Number two is Imam Muslim. Number three is Sunan Abi Dawood, Jami'u Tirmidhi, Sunan Nasa'i, and Sunan Ibn Majah. These six books are called what? What are they called? Kutub Sita. The scholars did not, at the early stage, they agreed on five. They agreed on the first five that I mentioned. The first five that I just mentioned. If you change the order, you're in trouble. I specifically chose that order because we're going to discuss each of those inshallah ta'ala fi athna'il kalam. Bukhari is first. We put second what? Muslim. What did we put third? Dawood. What did we put third? Jama' Tirmidhi. What did we fourth? Sunan Nasa'i. What did we put last? That was disputed. Should it be made added onto the sixth or not? The scholars, they previously called it Kutubul Khamsa. Are you with me? Like Abu Bakr al-Hazimi rahimahullah, he has a kitab called Shurut Kutubi al-Khamsa. Published, it's Mutawidawal. And he talks about the condition of five books. Which one did he not put in? Then the scholars felt that they had to bring a what? A sixth one. Then they disputed amongst themselves, which is the sixth? Okay, the first person who actually suggested a book to be the sixth one was Razid al-Abdali. He suggested Muwatta Imam Malik. Let's make the sixth book the Muwatta of Imam Malik. Okay, he suggested that. His name is Razim al-Abdali, who died in the year 535, in his kitab At-Tajridu fi al-Jam'i Bayna Sihah. Ibn Athir followed him in that view. And he made it, the sixth one, he made it what? Al-Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala. And then, Al-Imam Hafidh Al-Ala'i Al-Kaykaldi, Ala'uddin Al-Kaykaldi, rahimahullah, the great Shafi'i scholar, he felt that the sixth person should be made into the Sunan al-Darimi, Al-Imam al-Darimi Sunan. The sixth one should be made Sunan al-Darimi. This was the view held by Salahuddin Al-Khalil Al-Kaykaldi. By accident, I said Ala'uddin. I meant Ala'uddin Mughlatai. And Salahuddin Khalil Al-Kaykaldi, both of them, they said the sixth one should be Sunan al-Darimi. That's what they suggested. لكن أبو الفضل طاهر المقدسي, he came. And then he coined, or he chose the sixth one to be Sunan Ibn Majah. And then after him came Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi, he authored his kitab Al-Ikmal, and he made the six books that he's going to take on board be what? The six that was mentioned by Abu Fadl Tahir ibn Tahir al-Maqdisi. Are you with me, brothers? So Ibn Majah. Are you with me, brothers? And Abu Fadl Tahir al-Maqdisi mentioned in two of his books, Shurut Kutub al-Sitta, he called it, and added the sixth one. And he wrote another called Atrafi Kutubi al-Sitta. Are you with me, brothers? After him came Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi, the author of the kitab Umdatul Ahkam. And he took the opinion of Abu Fadl Tahir al-Maqdisi, and he made the sixth one what? Sunan ibn Majah, followed him in it. And then after him came Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi. Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi. And he chose the view of Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi and the view of Abu Tahir al-Maqdisi. And he made it Sunan ibn Majah in his kitab Tahdhib al-Kamal. And then after him came al-Dhahabi rahimahullah. And then after that, Ibn Hajar, and all of the talkhisat that you saw, Tahdhib and Taqrib and all of that, all of them are going according to the what? The six books as to be Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawood, Tirmidhi, Nasa'i, and Ibn Majah. Does that make sense? That's not a point that we need to have to know now, but it's good. It's good information to know, brothers. Okay, especially nowadays, everything has to be spoken about because people are open shubha. Why these? Here the question is, why Musnad Imam Ahmad was not added to the list? When he's the teacher of all of these people, and he's more knowledgeable than all of them. Are you with me, brothers? The reason is because Kutub Ahmad, Ahmad's kitab, it's even though Kutub Imam Ahmad has more, his conditions are stronger than Abi Dawud. But the reason is because Al-Imam Abi Dawud's kitab and Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah and Nasa'i and all of them, they are talking about a hadith al-ahkam, and that gives more precedence to anything else. Hukum, rulings. Are you with me, brothers? These four books, okay, they are dealing with ahadith al-ahkam. You know what ahadith al-ahkam means, right? Ahadith of worship, right? And your salah, and your zakah, and your psalm, and your hajj, and your ibadat that you need to come with, and nikah, and whatnot. These four books deal with it. Ahmed's one doesn't. Ahmed's kitab is masanid. What does musnad mean? Musnad means Abu Bakr, all of his narrations are in here. Umar, all of his narrations are here. And it's not whether it's ahkam or not, it doesn't matter. It's just as long as it's Umar's narrations. As long as it's Abu Bakr's narrations. Does that make sense, brothers? Are you with me, brothers?
Yes.
Which one are called sahih? Bukhari and Muslim. And anyone who calls other than Bukhari and Muslim sahih, Iraqi, what did he say? وَمَنْ عَلَيْهَا أَطْلَقَ الصَّحِيحَ فَقَدْ أَتَى تَسَاهُلًا صَرِيحًا. Anyone who calls other than صحيحين صحيح فقد أتى تساهلا صريحا. He's come with clear تساهل. تساهل means too lenient. That's wrong. And the scholar that did that was Al-Imam Al-Baghawi. Baghawi has a kitab called مصباح السنة. What did he do? He called Bukhari Muslim صحيح. And he called the other four حسن. So he said all of these books are حسن. Every hadith that's in Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i, Hassan. And all of the hadiths are in Bukhari and Muslim, they are what? Iraqi says, وَالْبَغَوِي إِذْ قَسَّمَ الْمَصَابِحَ إِلَى السِّحَاحِ وَالْحِسَانِ جَانِحَ أَنَّ السِّحَاحَ مَا رَوَوْهُ فِي السُّنَنْ رُدَّ عَلَيْهِ إِذْ بِهَا غَيْرُ الْحَسَنِ. What he's come with is not good. Why? Because we find in Abu Dawud hadith which are sahih. We find in Abu Dawud hadith which are Hassan. We find in Abu Dawud hadith which are da'if. And the same for the others. Are you with me, brothers? Rather, Ibn Majah, they said a hadith which is fabricated is in there. A hadith which is mawdu' is found in Ibn Majah. Does that make sense? So all three types of hadith are found in the other four. Does that make sense? Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i, we might find sahih, we might find Hassan, and we might find da'if. Let's go back to Bukhari now. That's what concerns us now. And Muslim, as a side point. Bukhari and Muslim, are there weak narrations in there? Scholars like Al-Imam al-Darqutni, Abu Ali al-Jayyani, the author of the kitab Taqeed al-Muhmal, Abu Mas'ud al-Badri, Abu Mas'ud al-Dimashqi, these three scholars I mentioned, specifically because they are Hufad al-Athbat. Are you with me, brothers? Let me repeat that again. Al-Imam al-Darqutni, the man who wrote... Brothers, wallahi, we have to ponder here. So we have today a person who has no understanding of the deen, and he says, Darqutni weakened the hadith. Darqutni wrote his Ilal al-Warida from the top of his head. It's a 20-volume book. It's a 20-volume book. Today's scholars, wallahi, cannot explain it in 10 years. They will sat down to explain that book. Darqutni amlahu min dhahri qalbi. He dictated it from his memory. Are you with me, brothers? So when Darqutni read Bukhari, and when he read Muslim, what did he do? He found some hadith that he thinks, okay, need second look. Are you with me, brothers? So he said these wordings, not the hadith in totality, but these wordings, al-fad, they are weak. Are you with me, brothers? He didn't do that alone. Darqutni did that. And Imam Abu Mas'ud al-Dimashqi did that. And Abu Ali al-Jayyani, he did that. Now I want you to all ponder here. When they did that, on what ground did they do it? This is vital that you understand it. What base were they using? They were using the science of hadith. They weren't using intellectually, it doesn't make sense to me. Are we all together? This is vital. Because a person who says Ali, Darqutni weakened the hadith, will say Darqutni weakened it on the science. Are you weakening it on a science or are you weakening it based on? Then صارت مشرقة وسرت مغربا فشتان بين مشرق ومغربي. Then Bukhari, Darqutni is on one side and you're on another side. Even then, when those three mountains of scholars criticized some wordings of Bukhari and Muslim, half the Mahajjah didn't let them go. He didn't let them go. He brought those narrations and their quotes and their statements in his Hadyu Sari, and he responded to it. What did he do? He responded to each and every one of their statements, and the haq is with Bukhari, not them. Are we all together, brothers? Does that make sense? Bukhari, when he wrote his sahih, what did he do? This is vital. This is important that we understand this. Bukhari said, لما ألفت الصحيح, when I authored my sahih, عرضته, I presented it to Ahmed ibn Hanbal. Are you with me, brothers? I presented this to who? Ahmed ibn Hanbal. And Ishaq ibn Rahuya and Ali ibn Madin. And they sat down and they read my book. From one side to the other side. These are what? Ahmed is who? Ishaq ibn Rahuya is who? Ali ibn Madin is who? They are a'immatu scholars, not just hadith. No. There are some people who know hadith. They were known as Ashabul Ilal. Ilal is a defect that's in the hadith, like not a normal person cannot see it. It's what is called, it has ghumud, it's khafi, it's hard for a person to catch it out. Are you with me, brothers? Like, for example, catching out a mudallis, catching out mursal al-khafi. These are hidden. Not everybody can see this. Who can see this? Jahabidatul Nuqat. Like Ahmed and Yahya ibn Ma'in and Abdurrahman al-Mahdi and Ishaq al-Fizari and Abdurrahman, Abdullah al-Mubarak and Abu Nu'ayn Fadl ibn Dukayn. These guys, these were huddaq. Are you with me, brothers? So when Bukhari brought his sahih to Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and he brought it to Ishaq ibn Rahuya, and he brought it to Ali ibn Madini, each and every one of them are imams uniquely. One was enough, but he brought it to all three of them. And they criticized four narrations they brought out. And do you know what Uqayli said? Abu Ja'far al-Uqayli, rahimahullah, he said, وَالْقَوْلُ قَوْلُ الْبُخَارِي. Even those four that they criticized, the truth and the haq is with who? Al-Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala. The haq was with him. So we're not saying Bukhari's kitab, it's, what do you call it, like the Quran. We scholars have criticized it, la shak. But when you criticize it, use the sana'a, use the science of hadith and prove it to us. And then the response will be based on what? The science of hadith. It won't be based on what? I don't like this hadith because it logically doesn't make sense to me. Then this is another story, it's another discussion. ولذلك, I want to say something, بإذنالله الكريم, which is the rejection of hadith, and the people who rejected hadith are two types. Note this down, it's very important that you memorize and you remember this. Those who've rejected hadith are two types. There are people whose rejection of hadith is what's called rad mutlaq. Rad mutlaq means what? They unrestrictedly reject the hadith. And they're the ones we commonly call them, or nowadays we call them the Al-Qur'aniyun. They're not Qur'aniyun aslan. We shouldn't call them. We should call them Munkiri Sunnah. Because a Qur'an is a person who follows the Qur'an, and the Qur'an says to you what? Follow that? Allah says, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِيمَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِّمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ الله says, وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا وَفَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَمَا اخْتَلَفْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَحُكْمُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ آيات you can get وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ Ayat in the Quran, all of them say that we follow the Sunnah, brothers. Are you with me? So we call them Quraniyun, that's wrong. Because they're not Quraniyun, they don't follow the Quran. They are rejectors of the Sunnah. That's the name we should give them. Okay? They just reject the Sunnah. So that's the first type of rejection of hadith. A lot of people, that's the one they recognize and they say, oh, he doesn't take hadith. But there's a second type of rejectors. Who are they? They are called Rad Muqayyad. Their rejection of hadith is restricted. And there are two types. They are what? They are two types. Those, one of them is, those who reject the hadith بمجرد عقولهم, based on their logic. And Islamically, historically, we saw those group of people. They were the Mu'tazila. The Mu'tazila rejected the sunnah based on what? عقول. Are you with me? A hadith would be mentioned to them and they would refuse it. Because it doesn't logically make sense to them. Are you with me, brothers? And at our era and our time we're living, there were people who pushed that. For example, the Kitab Anwar al-Sunnah by Abu Rayya, which AbdulRahman al-Mu'allim refuted later in his Kitab Al-Anwar al-Kashifa. He was a rejecter of the Sunnah, like his Rad was what? It was Muqayyad. Some scholars, they say it's Rad Mutlaq Aslan. But I could have, he was a rejecter of Sunnah. Are you with me, brothers? Also, Jamaluddin al-Afghani and Muhammad Abdu, these people, they were rejecters of the Sunnah. And also, al-Shaykh, rahimahullah ta'ala, al-Shaykh Muhammad Rashid Rida, even though he did spread Sunnah, and he did give Nusra to some of the works of Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, but even then, his Majallatul Manar, sometimes he used to allow the Qur'aniyun to spread their ideology in there. Are you with me? He would let it, rahimahullah rahmatan, wasi'ah. Here now you understand. This ideology of rejecting the Sunnah is not new. The second type of rejecting, which is muqayyad, is those who reject it based on khabarul ahad. That's a form of rejection, but it's restricted. Those who say we only take ahadith when they are what? When they're mutawatir. But if they are few in number, we don't take them. It, within themselves, they disputed. The Mu'tazila, what did they say? We don't take khabarul ahad fil i'tiqad wal ahkami ma'an. Together. That's the view of who? The Mu'tazila, they say we do not take singular narration, whether it's in ahkam related issues or whether it's aqidah related issues. That's the belief of the Mu'tazila. Like in the Asha'ira, what did they say? Only aqidah related issues. We accept it in ahkam related issues, but we don't. They contradicted themselves because every hukum needs a belief. Are you with me, brothers? You have to believe the salah is wajib aslan before you pray it, right? So the belief itself is based on a khabar ahad. Are you with me, brothers? Now we come to nowadays, we find people who do that. So if anybody says to you, I don't take khabar ahad in aqidah, you just have to know that he's a rejecter of the sunnah. Na'am, his rejection is not the rejection which is mutlaq, but it's a rejection which is muqayyad. He's the next step for him is what? Mutlaq. It's what? Ibn Abdul Bar, when he came to the ayah, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِيلَ إِلَيْهِمْ, he said that the sunnah, where did it come? What did the sunnah come to do, brothers? Yeah? The sunnah, what did it come to do? To clarify that? Ibn Abdul Bar said something gold. Statement which is gold. Write this down, it's important for you. You'll benefit from it. In his kitab, Jami' Bayan al-Ilm wa Fadli. He mentions that the sunnah came to explain the Qur'an in two ways. Number one, the ambiguous verses in the Qur'an that we don't know, which we can't implement, the sunnah comes and explains it for us. Like وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ, pray the salah. We don't know how to do it, the sunnah came and it taught us. The second type of وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَا is the Qur'an, the sunnah will come with حُكُم زَائِدَةً عَنِ الْقُرْآنِ. It will come with an additional ruling which you will not find in the Qur'an. It's coming with new rulings, the Qur'an, sunnah. Like marrying a girl and her maternal auntie, you won't find that in the Qur'an. That's found in where? Sunnah mentions this. Are you with me, brothers? It's a hukum which is za'idah. It's an additional ruling. Anybody who rejects the sunnah, all of these, he can't find this in the Qur'an. He cannot find it where? ولذلك حافظ الحكمي he said وبعد إن أشرف العلوم بعد كتاب الصمد القيوم علم الحديث إذ هو البيان لما به قد أنزل القرآن فسنة النبي وحي ثان عليه ما قد أطلق وحيان وإنما طريقها الرواية فافتقر الراوي إلى الدراية بصحة المروية عن الرسول ليعلم المردود من مقبول لا سيما عند التظاهر الفتن ولبس إفك المحدثين بالسنن فقام عند ذلك الأئمة بخدمة الدين ونصح الأمة وخلصوا صحيحها من مفترى حتى صفت نقية كما ترى. The sunnah is the second source of our religion. And Allah protected it through who? The Jahabilatul Nuqat. These scholars of hadith. They came and what did they do? وخلصوا صحيحها من مفترى. They cleansed it from the weak and the حتى صفت. Until he became what? Safi. Pure. Hatta safat naqiyatan kama tara. So what you realize, you have to realize, brothers, is anyone who criticized Bukhari, they couldn't criticize the Prophet, so they used Bukhari as a shield. That's the truth. Criticizing Bukhari is a stepping, because what's, somebody's going to ask you, what's your most authentic source after the Quran? What are they going to say? You're going to say Bukhari, right? The person takes down Bukhari. What are you left with? Every other masadir goes. I don't need to say that to you. So what goes? Hadith goes in totality. There's no hadith left for you. I just showed you that your most authentic book is what? So you have to realize where the issue is. But that's not an answer we give and we just leave it there. We still go in more details. Okay? Let's go in, inshallah ta'ala, to the book. The way we're going to go through it is, inshallah ta'ala, let's understand the sahih. Let's understand this book first of all. So we're going to define the sahih, right? We're going to what? Define Sahih al-Bukhari. How are we going to define Sahih al-Bukhari? In three ways. I want you to remember, write this down. Three ways we're going to define Sahih al-Bukhari. How many ways? Three ways. Number one is, what's the name of this book? Why do we have to know the name of the book? Because the name gives us understanding of what the book is talking about. Are you with me, brothers? Ah, it's important. What's this book called, Aslan? The second way I'm going to explain, show and define the book is, why did he author this book? Again, will give us another understanding of what the book is dealing with. Why? Why did he write this? The third one is, what does this book talk about? Are you with me, brothers? Which we should have had an understanding from, but from the first and the second, and then the third one is just finishing off the extra points that you need to know. Let's start by mentioning the name of the book. The author, the scholars, they disputed one another in the name of the book in two names. And they're both close in name. They are both what? They are both close in a name. The first one is mentioned by Imam al-Nawwi in his Kitab Tahdhib al-Asma'i wal-Lughat. He said it's called Al-Jami' Al-Musnad Al-Sahih المختصر من أمور رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وسننه وأيامه. He called it الجامع. What does that mean? We're standing over the. So first قول, and then we'll explain each of those names. Each one has a meaning. Okay, what does جامع mean? جامع means that the books of hadith are written in different types. You have to know that first. Kutub al-Hadith, when we look at it today, they're written in different ways. Are you with me, brothers? Over 50 different ways. Now I'm going to go through each of the words, so you'll know, write it down as I say the word. So first one, what, point is what? The books of Hadith are written in different ways. 50 different ways, but I'm just going to mention a couple of them. Some books of Hadith, they talk about only what? A Hadith al-Ahkam. You're only going to learn hukum from it. They're not going to do heart softening. They're not going to talk about Akhirah and Day of Judgment. No, no, no. They don't do tafsir. They only talk about what? Hukum. Ruling. Halal or haram. Does that make sense? Which one? Abu Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i. Okay? There's another type of book, which is called Ajza. Ajza. You'll see it. Juz. Raf'u al-Yadayn. Juz. Qira'at khalf al-Imam. Juz. Juz. What does Juz mean? Juz means it discusses a particular issue. This book, it's only going to talk about a particular issue. Are you with me? Like raf'ul yadayn, raising the hands. Or reciting behind the imam. This is juz. Juz means designated, specific for a particular topic at hand. Does that make sense? Bukhari wrote those two books. Raf'ul yadayn, which we spoke about, and qira'at khalfi al-imam. They are exact juz. Good. The third type of writing is books which are called jami'. What are they jami'? Jami'. The third type are jami'. What does jami' mean? Comprehensive. What comprehensive? Everything it talks about. So you will find in it, what would you find in it? Ahadith al-Ahkam. What will you also find in it? Heart softening. What would you also find in it? Manaqib, virtues. What would you also find? Tafsir. What would all of that is in there? So Bukhari's kitab is what? Jama. Gonna be all of that in there. It's gonna talk about aqidah. It's gonna be talk about tawheed. It's gonna be talking about ahkam. It's gonna be talking about umurul akhirah. It's gonna talk about manaqib, tafsir, all of it. So that's the first point of the name of the book. So we already have an understanding what this book is. It's a jama. Hey, father. We're gonna discuss it. Tell me there's a khilaf on it. Okay, if it's a jami' or not. I think we should leave it when we talk about Tirmidhi, inshallah ta'ala. Okay? But there is that discussion. Some are calling it jami', some are calling it sunan. And there's a reason why they called it jami' and sunan. Because they're a book to be jami', there's a number of books that have to be found in it to be called jami'. I had a decision to memorize it. Sheikh Muhammad Ali Adim Ethiopi mentions it in his, one of his nazm. But فَمَا أَنْسَانِهُ إِلَّا الشَّيْطَانَ أَنَا ذَكُرَ. Shaitan made me forget to memorize those lines of how many babs have to be in a book to be called a jami'. Sheikh Muhammad Ali Adim Ethiopi, he says that there's I forgot the number, but there's this much of chapters that have to be in a book to be called a jami'. Now it goes, it's a jami'. If one of those chapters is missing from it, it's not called a jami'. So Tirmidhi didn't meet that criteria, that's what they say. Are you with me, brothers? Ala kulli hal. Bukhari is a jami'. What is it? It's a jami'. The second part of the name is al-musnad. Musnad means what? The hadith which are connected, chained. Musnad here doesn't mean the Musnad of Imam Ahmad or the Musnad of Tayalisi. No, it means Musnad a hadith which are chained. So this is something powerful because Bukhari has in his Sahih a hadith which are mu'allaqa. The mu'allaqat are not of his condition because that's not what he authored his book for. They're side points. The hadith that he's talking about is what? Al-Musnad. The hadith that have chained. Are you with me, brothers? No. Did that make sense? Yeah. The ahadith which Bukhari is, when he says my book is authentic, he's talking about the hadith which are that he bought a chain for. If you come across a hadith which he doesn't bring a chain for, it's not a hadith that he wants you to see it as the ones he's talking about to be the sahih ones. Are you with me, brothers? Does that make sense? These are points. We're going to come to the mu'allaqat and discuss it in more details, inshallah ta'ala. And why he brought them, and the different types of mu'allaqat, sigat al-jazmi, sigat al-tamrid, and are all the sigat al-jazmi indahu sahih, is it not? We'll talk about that. But Ibn Hajar, he did a book on that, just the mu'allaqat. He authored a specific book on it. Brothers, I want you to understand something. I cannot talk about Imam al-Bukhari sahih in one day or two. Ibn Hajar was writing it for 16 years. 16 years he was writing Hadith Sari. Wallahi, 16 years he was writing Bukhari Sahih. And what this book is, studying it. I'm telling you, this is a madrasa, this book is. This book is something else. Wallahi, it's a unique book. Rather, Sheikh Abdul Haq al Hashimi from India, he wrote a 15 volume book on just the chapters of Bukhari. Forget anything else, forget the hadith, forget the chain. Just the chapterings in his Sahih. Lubbul al-Bab, he called it. Wait, what did he talk about? Are you with me, brothers? The 30 volume that Bashar Awad Ma'ruf done the tahqiq on the kitab Tahdib al-Kamal. Are you with me, brothers? 4 or 5 volumes of those are Bukhari's Rijal. Are you with me? We're going to speak about the books that are written on it. How many scholars explain Sahih al-Bukhari? Are you with me, brothers? How many explanations have been put on Sahih al-Bukhari? Some of the scholars, they mentioned 300 explanations. How many? Why would people waste their time on that? The book doesn't have that value. We'll see it, inshallah ta'ala. So the first name is Jami', and then second is what? Al-Musnad. Third one is what? Al-Mukhtasar. So Al-Jami' and Al-Musnad. Third is what? Al-Mukhtasar. But this is still the name we're saying. Why Al-Mukhtasar? Bukhari, to him, it is not the only ahadith that are sahih on the face of this earth are not in his sahih. Don't get that wrong. There are other ahadith that he didn't narrate, that he himself saw it to be sahih, but he didn't bring it in his sahih. ولذلك listen to this. Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi, who's going to come to us later, who's been Ruwat al-Bukhari. We'll come to him later, inshallah, and we're going to study who has this riwayah. Because some people think Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Firabri, his only narration has reached us. Kadib, Zur, Buhtar, Tadlil. We have the narration of Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi, and it's the sharh of al-Imam Abu Sulaiman ibn Hamad al-Khattabi. His kitab A'lam al-Hadith am A'lam al-Sunan, whichever one you want to call it. The sharh depends on the riwayah of Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi. Even Abu Ali al-Jayyari, he's in Taqeed al-Muhammad, he brings parts of it, portions of it. Are you with me, brothers? This is something, this is a side point we're going to come to later. This is the most important part. Now let's go back to Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi, who he said, سمعت I heard Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari يقول, saying, ما أدخلت في كتاب الجامع إلا ما صحة. I have only placed in this book of mine that which is authentic. Okay. وَتَرَقْتُ I have left مِنَ الصِّحَاحِ a hadith which were authentic, I left them. Why? كَيْ لَا يَطُولَ الْكِتَابُ so my book doesn't become a مُطَوَّن. It doesn't become too much. It then is a مُخْتَصَر. My book is summarized. Are you with me, brothers? It's a مُخْتَصَر. Good. What is it مُخْتَصَر for? مِنْ أُمُورِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ the affairs of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam وَسُنَنِهِ and the Prophet's way. So now, you know what it's dealing with. It's not dealing with anything other than the sunnah of the Prophet. Are you with me, brothers? Here the scholars, they discussed, okay, what about the marfu'at and the mawqufat and the maqtu'at in Bukhari? The hadith which are attributed to the companions but not the Prophet. What about the hadith that are in there which are attributed to the tabi'in? What about those narrations? We'll talk about that. It's going to come, inshallah ta'ala. But Bukhari didn't condition those ones. These are the only ones he conditioned. Are we all together? From the book, straight away, what did we learn? A bit about what's inside the book, true or false? The second name that the scholars disputed, that it's called, is what Ibn Hajar mentioned himself in his Hadith Sari, which is, it's called Al-Jami'u Sahih Al-Musnad. So the other one's called Jami'u Al-Musnad Al-Sahih. This one is Jami'u Al-Sahih Al-Musnad, and the word Mukhtasar is missing, that's it. And the word? So the Musnad and Sahih back and forth, back and this one goes before this one, and this one goes before. And Ibn Hajar's one, the word Mukhtasar is missing. That's it. So it seems like which one is more better? Nawawi's one's better. Nawawi's one's better. That's the one we're gonna follow, inshallah ta'ala. The second point that we're gonna go to is why did he author this book? Okay, why did he author this book? Three reasons scholars mentioned. Ibn Hajar specifically, I'm reading it from his Hadith Sari, he mentioned three reasons. The first reason he mentioned is Bukhari saw, rahimahullah ta'ala, the books that were written, the comprehensive in Sahih Hadith, they were little. So it drove him personally to be the person who goes out there and writes a what? A book in Hadith which are authentic. So there was an internal drive already there. That's one. Second one was what he heard from his teacher Ishaq ibn Rahuya. Ishaq ibn Rahuya said, if anyone from amongst you is talking to his students, he said, if only someone could what? Gather and bring together a summarized, authentic book in Hadith, it would have been something good. Now that Bukhari already had something in his heart, what happened? That even made it more stronger for him. Number three is, he said, رَأَيْتُ النَّبِيَّ I saw the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم وَكَأَنِّي بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ I saw the Prophet in a dream. And I was in front of him. And there were flies that were coming to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and I was defending and blocking those flies from going onto the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then he said, I went to a person who interprets the dreams, and I asked him, what is this dream? And he said to him that you're going to defend the Prophet's hadith. You're going to defend it from the allegations and things that are thrown at it. And he saw that to be another purpose for him to go to what? And they don't negate one another. All of those purposes could have driven him to do it. Are you with me, brothers? All of them could have happened to him, and they all pushed him to what? To write his sahih, rahimahullah ta'ala. The third point that I want to speak about is, what does this book deal with? I kind of touched on that. This book, the discussion and what it talks about is, okay, as I mentioned from the name, is that it's jami', it's comprehensive. It's going to talk about everything. Number two, it's going to be sahih. When we say sahih, what was sahih? Awwaluha, what's the first one? Mattasal. Isnaduhu wa lam yushadda aw yu'al. Yarwihi adlun, dhabitun an mithlihi mu'tamadun fi dhabtihi wa naqli baykuni, right? It's the hadith that meets 5 points. 5 points and conditions need to be found in it, and this hadith becomes what? Sahih. Wallahi, brothers, pay attention. Every point I'm saying here is vital because it's going to be a discussion later. Are you with me, brothers? Wala hadith is sahih. What does it have to be? Number one, chain of narration need to be connected. Connection of the chain. Awwaluha mattasal. It's connection. Number two is what? The narrators who are narrating the hadith have to be precise. They have to have full precision. They have to have complete precision in their memory. Number three is what? They have to be, integrity has to be good. They have to have adalah. Those three have to be present. And the next two have to be absent. Are you with me? Ijabiyah and salbiyah. These three have to be present. And these two have to be what? Absent, which we're going to mention, the next two. Which is what? It cannot have another narration opposing it. It can't have another narration opposing it. And number five is what? It can't have a defect. It can't have a hidden defect. Some of the people, what did they say? It can't have a defect. That's wrong. Because what? In Qatar, this connection is a defect. The narrator is not being reliable is a defect. Are you with me? Here the defect means hidden defect. Are you with me, brothers? One of the great scholars of this time, who mashallah mubarak, had that ilm of ilal, at this time was none other than Sheikh Muqbil ibn Hadi al-Wadi'i. Sheikh Muqbil had a kitab called Ahadith Mu'alla Zahiruha Siha. It's a good book you have to buy. Ahadith Mu'alla, ahadith that have defects. But when you look at it from the apparent, they're all connected, you will never ever say this hadith is da'if. Are you with me, brothers? Am I making sense here? Sheikh Muqbil at this era, he was hadiq. He was good at ilal of hadith. Rahimahullahu. Rahmatan wasi'ah. Now let's carry on. So, Bukhari, is he more authentic than Muslim? Who's more authentic, Bukhari or? The poet, he said, لَقَدْ تَشَاجَرَ قَوْمٌ فِي الْبُخَارِيُ وَمُسْلِمٌ فَقَالُوا بِأَيِّ دَيْنٍ تَقَدَّمُوا لَقَدْ فَاقَ الْبُخَارِيُ صِحَّةً كَمَا فَاقَ الْمُسْلِمُ صَنَاعَةً. Bukhari is better, more authentic than Muslim. Then how is it more authentic? It goes back to one of these five conditions. True or false? I'm not going to touch on it. We're going to come to al-mufadalatu bayna sahihayn. When we compare the two, we'll bring the statistics. We'll bring the numbers, the figures, and why Bukhari got an upper hand over Muslim. Give you numbers, reasons, so you know. What do you also know from this book? What does it deal with? It also deals with a hadith which are marfu'ah. The hadith that are attributed to who? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Also this book has another issue that many people don't know. Do you know what it also deals with? Istinbatat. Bukhari is extracting rulings from this hadith. He's not like all the other narrative books that are written. Bukhari, he's book chapterings. That itself is I told you, Abdul Haq al-Hashimi. He authored a book on the chapterings of Bukhari. And he wasn't the first to do that. Bukhari's chaptering itself is a science. Because he's trying to extract what? So this book, what are we learning from it? What are we learning from it? Fiqh rulings. scholars, what they did was they followed up Bukhari's book, his Sahih, and they realized that the four imams of madhabs, Bukhari was not a muqallid, he didn't follow madhab. He was a mujtahid mutlaq. There were two, from the six books of hadith, there were only two scholars who were mujtahid mutlaq. Are you with me, brothers? From the six books of hadith, the scholars that wrote it, two were only known, were considered to be mujtahid. Mujtahid mutlaq. Who was it? Bukhari and Abu Dawood. Ibn Taymiyyah mentioned that in his Majmu' al-Fatawa. Those are the two. The rest, they were not mujtahid mutlaq, but they were not muqallideen. No. They would never muqallid. But what they did was they looked at the aqwal that were out there and they chose what was right. Like, I'm not saying this because of another reason, but I want you to hear this out. Bukhari is sahih, when we look at his fiqhiyat, the fiqh that he extracts from his chapterings and everything, he more seems to be going in line, even though he doesn't look at a madhab aslan. Bukhari doesn't. What does he do? He looks at the hadith and the ayah and he brings the ruling out straight away. Because he's a mujtahid mutlaq. He doesn't look at who said it before him and what they said. He doesn't need that. He's got the tools, he's got everything. He looks at the Quran and reads the sunnah and he brings out rulings from it. Those rulings that he brought out, when you look at the four imams, which one did he agree the most with? Is none other than Imam Shafi'i. Allahumma barik. And that makes a lot of sense why he would do that. Oh, that why. Are you with me, brothers? The madhab which he seemed to go in more line with is the great Imam Muhammad Idris al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah. Are you with me, brothers? Hafid mentioned that, rahimahullah. Rather, he actually brings his view sometimes as a side point, Bukhari in his Sahih. Imam Shafi'i, rahimahullah. Are you with me? That shows he has ilmam and some understanding of who? He never met him, by the way. And Imam Bukhari did not meet? He did meet Shafi'i. Shafi'i died the year 204. And Bukhari was young at that moment, could have met him, but where was Imam Shafi'i at that time? He was in Egypt. He moved from Iraq at that time. And the time that he did go to Egypt, Shafi'i tawfiya, he passed away. I think we have to stop now, 7 o'clock. And there's going to be... we can carry on. Alhamdulillah. Now we're going to go into the second point, which is Ruwatu Sahih al-Bukhari, the narrators of Sahih al-Bukhari. This is going to be the longest one for all of us. And it's the hardest chapter that we'll ever speak about. You guys look tired. I'm the one who hasn't slept for 48 hours, wallahi. You guys ready for it? Are you sure? Okay, hey, faddal. Before I move on, everybody understood what I said before? Yeah? No break. Don't let them hear us. Okay, let's go in. Okay, Al-Imam al-Bukhari, when did I say he was born? 194. When did he die? 256. Correct? Okay. Bukhari, over 90,000 people narrated from him what? He's sahih. 90,000. Huh? The qa'ida is al-muthbit muqaddamun ala al-nafi. If Dhabi negates and another person affirms, who takes precedence? According to us, the one who affirms. لأنه زيادة علم, he has additional knowledge. Not to mention Muhammad Yusuf al-Farabi actually sat with Bukhari, so he knows it more. Like an Imam al-Dhabi, where did he come? 500 something years later. We'll take into consideration what he says, we'll give it weight, that's Zahabi. Like he will say, مَنْ عَلِمَ حُجَّةٌ عَلَى مَنْ لَمْ يَعْلَمُ. The one who knows is a proof over the one that doesn't know.
90,000 people heard it or 90,000 narrated
heard it, sorry. Jazakallah khairan. 90,000 didn't transmit it to us. Lakin there is discussion we're going to have around regarding whether Dhahabi said he'd heard it or not, they didn't reach us anyway. So the fact that Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, 90,000 could have heard it from him, most likely, because we just mentioned through his biography, whenever he came to Baghdad, what happened? People climbed up places. Are you with me? So the chances of him hearing these numbers from him is high. Lakin Imam al-Dhahabi is wallahi, jabal wallahi. Where did he say that, rahimahullah, in his seer? It was nice to see how he said it as well. Okay. Lakin, the people who narrated it from him, five are famous. We'll just stick with what's famous. How many are famous? Five are famous. Five are narrators, are well famous, known, those who heard from him. We know their names, we know their biographies. I'm not going to focus on every one of them in great details, okay? But I'll mention them. The first one is Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar al-Farabri. I'm a Firabri. The first one is Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar al-Firabri, who died the year 320. The second one is Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi. The third one is Hamad ibn Shakir al-Nasafi. The fourth one is Abu Talha Mansur ibn Muhammad al-Bazdawi. And the fifth, which is the last one, is Abu Abdullah al-Muhamili. One more time. Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar al-Farabri, Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi, Hamad ibn Shakir al-Nasafi, Abu Talha Mansur ibn Muhammad al-Bazdawi. And number five is Abu Abdullah al-Muhamili. Does that make sense? One more time. Three times is good, right? Last time. This is literally the last time. Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar al-Firabri. 13 people narrated from Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Firabri. How many? Ibn Hadr mentioned 9 in his Hadith Sari, and there are missing from him how many? 4 are missing from him. Add those 4. Are you with me, brothers? Second one is who? Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi. The third one is Hamad ibn Shakir al-Nasafi. The fourth one is Abu Talha Mansur ibn Muhammad al-Bazdawi. And the fifth one is Abu Abdullah al-Muhamili. Is it Muhamili or Muhamili? I don't know. I'll look into that more, inshallah. Is it Dhamma on it or not, or Fatha? I'm not 100% sure. I didn't get the chance to really look into that. So remember that. How many ruwat narrated from Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar in al-Farabri? 13. Half of the hadith, how many did he mention? How many is missing from him?
Four.
We're going to go through each one. Don't worry. Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi, his narration, 2 books are dependent on it. Meaning, if we want to see the riwayat of Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi's one, if we want to see it today, the book that we go to find those narrations of his, his wordings, and we'll speak about what we mean by that. But the riwayah, the chain for Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi goes back to Abu Sulaiman ibn Muhammad al-Khattabi. Al-Imam al-Khattabi, his kitab A'lam al-Sunan, are you with me, brothers? Ama A'lam al-Hadith, it's called both of those names. Some scholars, they call it A'lam al-Hadith, and some call it A'lam. Don't confuse it with his other book, which is called Ma'alim al-Sunan, which is a sharh of Sunan Abi Dawud. Ma'alim al-Sunan is his sharh of Sunan Abi Dawud. No, this one's called A'lam al-Sunan or A'lam al-Hadith. And who is this? Abu Sulaiman Hamad ibn Muhammad al-Khattabi. Are you with me? His explanation of Bukhari, Khattabi has an explanation of Bukhari. A'lam al-Sunan is called, or A'lam al-Hadith. His copy is dependent on which riwayah? Riwayat Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi. Are you with me, brothers? Good. Because he took his one from Khalaf ibn al-Khayyam. He's directly taken it from Khalaf ibn al-Khayyam. Also, the other person who's got that copy, that riwayah, is Abu Ali al-Jayyani. He has a kitab called Taqyid al-Muhmal. Abu Ali al-Jayyani has a kitab called Taqyid al-Muhmal. He also has in it the riwayah of Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi. Does that make sense? That's good. Hafiz ibn Hajar also brings it in his Fath al-Bari. Hafiz ibn Hajar has a sanad to it. And he brings it in his Fath al-Bari. Even that though Fath al-Bari, we're going to come to it later, Fath al-Bari does not rely on that riwayah. The riwayah of Fath al-Bari is the riwayah of Abi Dhar al-Harawi and Mashayikhi Thalatha. Abi Dhar al-Harawi from his three shuyukhs, Abu al-Haytham al-Kushmihani and Ibn Hamuyat al-Sarakhsi, Ibn Hamuyat al-Sarakhsi. I'm a Sarakhsi, however you want to say it. And Al-Sijzi, Abu Ishaq Al-Sijzi. Those three riwayah, which Abi Dhar al-Harawi narrated from, half Mahajid, that's the sharh, that's the one he depends mainly on. Are you with me, brothers? But I'll come to that. I know I spoke a bit too fast, because that's under Muhammad Yusuf Farabi's riwayat. We're not going to come to that. One more time. Because I spoke about, I went off topic. Let me bring you back again. How many people heard Bukhari Sahih from him? Yeah? 90,000 heard from him. How many are the most common and the famous narrations that have reached us? Five. What's the first one? Riwayat who? Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar al-Farabriyu. What year did he die? 320. He died what year? How many people narrated from Firabri? 13. Okay. Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi, his narration, whose books is the Mu'tamad? Which book is the Mu'tamad for it? Which book is the Mu'tamad means which book relies on it? A'lam al-Sunan al-Imam al-Khattabi. That's the asl for it. And also it's found in which one? Abu Ali al-Jayyani's kitab Taqyidu. Taqyidu al-Mu'mal is published today. It's published. Dar Ali ibn Fawaid published it, two copies. Ali al-Imrani, you know Ali al-Imrani? The muhaqqiq of Kutub ibn Taymiyyah with Muhammad Uzair Shams. Muhammad Uzair Shams is from India, right? And he's one of the great mutakhassisin in the works of Ibn Taymiyyah.
He's in Makkah.
Yeah, he's in Makkah, yeah, he lives in Makkah now. He worked with, Ali al-Imrani. Ali al-Imrani, I don't know if Muhammad Uzair Shams done the tahqiq of the kitab, Taqeed al-Mu'man, I don't know, but I know Ali al-Imrani did. It's published, it's two volumes, you can find it. And it's a very good copy, alhamdulillah. Before the copies were mistakes in it. Like this one is very good. So two scholars, brothers, we can find the riwayat Ibrahim ibn Aqal al-Nasafi. What about the riwayat of Hamad ibn Shakir, which is the third one? When did, Ibrahim ibn Aqal al-Nasafi die? 295. What year did he die? 295. Hamad ibn Shakir is the third version. The scholars that depended on this one, or we find it with them, or have this, is Abu Abdullah al-Hakim al-Naysaburi. Imam Hakim al-Naysaburi, he has a tariqah and a riwayah for it. You find it with him. And also Imam al-Bayhaqi. Ibn Hajar, he also has it in his Fath al-Bari. He brings it. The fourth one is, what year did he die? 311. Hamad ibn Shakir died 311. The fourth one is Abu Talha Mansur ibn Muhammad al-Bazdawi. He died in the year 329 Hijriah. Abu Talha Mansur ibn Muhammad al-Bazdawi. Abu Talha Mansur ibn Muhammad al-Bazdawi. He died in the year 329. His copy, Hafiz ibn Hajar brings it in his Fath. Abu al-Abbas al-Mustaghfiri is also in there as well. Abu Abdullah al-Mahamili. Abu Abdullah al-Mahamili, which is the last one, he died in 330. So who's the last person who died from all of them? Yeah? So he was the last person to narrate the Sahih, right? That's important for you to know. ولذلك Firabri did a mistake when he said I was the last to narrate it. Because who died after two people? Abu Talha al-Masur, Muhammad al-Bazdawi narrated it. And who also who? Al-Mahabi. Some scholars, they came back and they responded, the reason why Firabri said I am the last one to narrate it means, he means the strongest in the Sahih. وَهَذَا لَا شَكَ فِيهِ. If he means I am the most strongest in the Sahih, then there's no debate about that. And he was the strongest, because we're going to study him the most right now. For what? For two reasons. And we're going to dismiss the other riwayat. For two reasons. Number one, the other riwayat did not reach us sama'. Note that down. The other riwayat, they did not reach us sama'. Sama' means what? Hearing. No, it didn't. They came through ijazah. Some of them were ijazat. There's a difference between, you know the difference between sama' and ijazah? Sama' means Bukhari, all of it you read on this person. Or they read it on you. Fully, you heard it, beginning to end. That's what? That's sama'. Ijazah is the Sheikh says to you, I know you know Bukhari, I'll give you my ijazah. The other four, they have ijazat, and other than that are in it. Lakin Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar al-Firabri's riwayah is sama'. It's reached us now, sama'. Ibn Hajar has it, sama'. Are you with me, brothers? Second reason is because Firabri, his copy is the most complete. It's the most akmal riwayat. Why is it the most complete? Because he heard it from Bukhari twice. How many times did he hear it from Bukhari? He heard it from Imam al-Bukhari twice. He heard it from Bukhari before he died. How many times? Let me get the kalam of the year in which he heard it from him. Who knew this information? Put your hand up if you really knew this. And this wasn't the first time you heard these ruwat. No one, huh? No one knew. This is what he said. Firabri, you heard from Bukhari the Sahih twice. The first time he heard it in Firabra, his place, his hometown. Sanata 48, 248. Write that down. The first time Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar al-Firabri heard from Bukhari was when? 248. The second time he heard it from him in Bukhara, when was it? 252. Bukhari died how many years later? 4 years later, Bukhari passes away. Are you with me, brothers? So he has the last version of it. He has what? One of the last versions of Al-Imam. Let's now go into the people who heard from Muhammad ibn Yusuf al. Let's mention them and then we'll go to his biography. Okay? Okay. Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar al-Farabi was born what year? 231 and he died the year 320. He's very old. How long was he? 90, right? 89. Yeah? 89. Yeah, 89 years he lived for. So he really reached an old age. How many people narrated from him? 13. Due to time, let's summarize the most important ones. Or shall I mention all the names?
Yes,
all three, okay. Mention it quickly, yeah? Okay, let me say the names that are narrated from Imam al-Bukhari, Muhammad Yusuf al-Farabri. Riwaya to Abi Ali ibn Sakan, write it. Abu Ali ibn Sakan. Abu Ali ibn Sakan. He died in 353. Abu Ali ibn Sakan. Number two is Abi Zayd al-Maruzi. Abu Zayd al-Marwazi. Abu Zayd al-Marwazi. Are you with me? Number three, right? Abu Ishaq al-Mustamli. Abu Ishaq al-Mustamli. Al-Akhsikati. Abu Nasr. Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Ahmed al-Akhsikati. He narrated from Farabri. Al-Akhsi Kati. How many we on? Abu Ali ibn Shabuyata. Abu Ali ibn Shabuyata. Shabuyata. Abu Ahmed al-Jurjani. أبو محمد ابن حموية السرخسي. أم السرخسي. أبو محمد ابن حموية السرخسي. أم السرخسي. أبو محمد ابن حموية السرخسي. أم السرخسي. أبو الهيثم. أبو الهيثم الكشميهني. أبو الهيثم الكشميهني. أبو علي الكشاني. أبو علي الكشاني. أحمد النعيمي. أبو بكر محمد بن أحمد. محمد بن خالد الفربري. محمد بن خالد الفربري. How much did I mention? Yeah. هيا. Who did I miss? Ha, Ahmed ibn Abdullah. Ahmed ibn Abdullah ibn Muhammad. Do you have how much do you have now? 13. You have 13. Within those 13, take down 3. The first one is Abu Ishaq al-Mustamli. Take down for me Abu Ishaq al-Mustamli. The second one is Abu al-Haytham al-Kushmihani. The second one is Abu al-Haytham al-Kushmihani. And the third one is Abu Muhammad ibn Hammuyat al-Sarakhsi. I'm a Sarakhsi. Are you there, brothers? Does that make sense, brothers? Has everyone written that down?
Yeah.
Those three, Abu Dhar al-Harawi narrated from them. Abu Ishaq al-Mustamli. Abu Muhammad ibn Hammuyat al-Sarakhsi. Abu al-Haytham al-Kushmihani. Those three. Who narrated from them? Abu Dhar al-Harawiyyu. Are you there, brothers? That's the copy that Hafidh ibn Hajar relied on in Fath al-Bari. Fath al-Bari, what is it on? Which copy is it on? Riwayat Abi Dhar al-Harawi al Mashayikhihi Thalatha. From his three shuyukhs. Who are his three shuyukhs? Abu Ishaq al-Mustamni, number one, hey? Abu Muhammad ibn Hammuyat al-Saraqsi. And the third one is? Abu al-Haytham al-Kushmihani. Are you there, brothers? There's another person I want to mention, and she is deserving of mentioning, is Karima al-Marwaziyah. Karima al-Marwaziyah was a woman who also narrated from Abi al-Haytham al-Kushmihani. She narrated from him. And she was a contemporary of Abi Dhar al-Harawi. Like she was a student with Abi Dhar al-Harawi. Are you there, brothers? Karima, she had students that took knowledge from her. From them was Khatib al-Baghdadi. Khatib al-Baghdadi, who took from Karima al-Marwaziyah. And she was a woman who was an abida. She refused to get married. So I'm never going to get married. She turned down the idea of marriage and she cut herself for ilm and ta'lim and tadris. Her life should be spoken about more. If anybody would come to her, she was excessively diligent that she would say to them, let me narrate the hadith for you. Give me your copy. When he wrote it, she would say, give me your copy. And she would compare it to her original copy. And then she would give it to them. That's the type of person she was, rahimahullah azza wa jalla. And it's an aspiration for the sisters to know that, subhanAllah, from the ruwat of Bukhari is her. Karimata al-Marwazi, she's part of it. Very good. Now, we're going to go into who? Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar al-Farabi. First of all, before I go into it, how does everybody feel? Everything's good? Fadal, ask questions.
Do you know the other narrations that you mentioned? You said that they were preserved as well. But from what we heard from some individuals, they said that the only one that was preserved was from Egypt. Is that something which is incorrect information?
Of course it is. We have the riwayah of Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi narrated in who? A'lam al-Sunan, A'lam al-Hadith. I came across somebody saying that. That's ajeeb. Al-Imam al-Bukhari's, how is it possible that half of Muhajjah mentions it in Fath al-Bari? Half of Muhajjah, Fath al-Bari, he mentions those riwayat.
Are all the rest of them complete?
No, some of them are not complete.
Okay.
They're not complete necessarily. But even if we found the remaining, who would say that the copies would be excessively different? Because even what we have right now, the differences are very little. Of course they are. We're going to go into the riwayat and the nusakh, inshallah ta'ala. Are you with me, brothers? The copies were? Were excessively different. One of the fascinating statements I came was that when he was talking about Sharafuddin al-Yunini, rahimahullah, Sharafuddin al-Yunini and Ibn Malik, rahimahullah, when they came together and they were collaborating in making sure that they bring the best copies. And then Yunini, what did he do? He took the riwayat of Asakir and the riwayat of Asili and the other riwayat and he was bringing it together. He said that Imam Malik was adding whatever wordings he wanted into the hadith. Wallahi, no one's ever said that. No one ever said that they were adding what they wanted. They were comparing which copies were there, and Ibn Malik's job was to grammatically mention each of those hadith, what was the grammatical analysis for it. That was his job. That's because he's a mutakhassis in that field. Like he has views in... وعود خافض لدى عطف على ضمير خفض لازما قد جعل وليس عندي لازما إذ قد أتى في النظم والنثر الصحيح مثبتا. He goes against the جمهور. Ibn Malik, رحمه الله. So Ibn Malik's job was what? We're going to speak about it in more details, the whole story, the riwayat, the stories that have come, exactly what each person's role was, who delegated them to do this job, was it in a gathering which was closed between them two only, or the other people? We'll speak about that, inshallah.
You know, Abu Ahmed al-Durjani, where is he from? From the west?
No. Why Durjani? Why do you think?
Because
In terms of robbery, you said about his, you know, his trustworthiness in narrating. I don't even know that that said his fiqh is all that came 200 years later. And the least that we have is 100 years later. And none of his contemporaries said that he was trustworthy.
And Imam, no one said he isn't. No one said he is, and no one. He isn't. And the fact that Bukhari trusted him to take his sahih from him twice, هذا وحده يكفي. Are you with me, brothers? And also what يكفي is تلقته الأمة بالقبول. The Ummah unanimously agreed with him. Are you with me, brothers? Like in Bukhari trusted him with it twice.
Do we have some other people to say that Bukhari trusted it with him twice?
Ha, Abu Bakr al-Sam'ani rahimahullah said that. Abu Bakr al-Sam'ani rahimahullah said that. That he said that Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Farabri asking about him, I'll bring the aqwal inshallah, I'm going to go to it now, bi-idhnillah. We're going to go to the kalam. They even rejected anyone asking about him. Like, why would you ask about Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Farabri? Don't even ask about him. Let me read the aqwal of the ulama. Yeah, we're gonna come to it. We're now gonna go to Farabri's biography. That's what we're gonna mention now. Okay, who's Abu Abdullah al-Farabri? We're gonna go through each of the people we mentioned right now. Which three are we gonna focus on highly? Abu Ishaq al-Mustamli, Abu Muhammad ibn Hamuyat al-Sarakhsi, and who else? Abu al-Haytham al-Kushmihani. We're going to focus on those and Abu Dharr al-Harawi. Okay? And Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Farabri. We're going to focus on that. We're going to leave the rest aside. Because this one is what became most famous. Okay? Farabri, who is he? He is al-Muhaddith, al-Thiqa, al-Alim al-Rawi al-Jami' al-Sahih. Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar ibn Salih ibn Bishr al-Farabri. His biography can be found. Are you with me? His biography. It can be found in the following books. Al-Mu'talif wal-Mukhtalif lidar al-Qutniyu. Al-Ikmal by Ibn Makula. Masharik al-Anwar wal-Ansab wa Mu'jam al-Buldan wa Taqyid wa Takmilat al-Ikmal wa Lubbu fi Tahdib al-Asma wa Kamil fi Tariq wa Muqaddimat al-Nawwi ala Sharh al-Bukhari wa Ifayat al-A'yan wa Barajim al-Tajribi wa Ifadat al-Nush wa Rawd by Mi'tar. Wa Kashf al-Asrar wa Tariq al-Islam wa Sir Alam al-Nubala wa Al-Ibra fi Khabari man Ghabar. والوافي بالوفيات ومرآة الجنان ومقدمة of ابن ملقنس توضيح وفيات ابن قنذر ابن قنفذ sorry وتوحيد المشتبه لابن ناصر الدين وتبصير by ابن حجر شذرات لابن عماد ديوان الإسلام. All of those books spoke about his tarjama. Not one person said he's weak. Dar Qutni looked at Bukhari to get one mistake from it. Did his eye not catch Farabi? Why couldn't he see it? It's funny, in the same breath you say that Darqutni weakened the Sahih, some hadith, so we can weaken it. Then why do you take his authentication of Farabri and all the Ruwat in Sahih? Or do you only take it? أَحَلَالٌ عَلَى بَلَابِلِهِ الدَّوْ حَلَالُ الطَّيْرِ مِنْ كُلِّ جِنْسِ. Do you only take Darqutni when it goes in line? Darqutni believed Sahih al-Bukhari is authentically transmitted to its author. Why do you take that from him? Are you the brothers? فَيُحِلُّونَهُ عَامًا وَيُحَرِّمُونَهُ عَامًا لِيُوَاطِئُ عِدَّةَ مَحَرَّمَ اللَّهِ. That's what it really is. Okay. Abu Bakr al-Sam'ani, what he said in his Amali, he said, وَقَدْ سَمِعَ الْفَرَبْرِيُّ فَرَبْرِي heard from مِنْ قُتَيْبَةِ مُسَعِيدِ. This is another mistake that the brother or the individual fell into. قُتَيْبَةُ فَرَبْرِي did hear from قُتَيْبَةِ مُسَعِيدِ. صحيح. And that's صح. قُتَيْبَةِ مُسَعِيدِ is who? Bukhari's teacher. Even Dahabi did a mistake in this issue. It's a mistake that Dahabi fell into and people just follow it. See, when Imam says something, go out of your way and read it more up the ladder. What did the Salaf or those earlier than said he said it? He did. So he's not only Bukhari's student, but he actually shares with Bukhari and Muslim what? في الرواية عنهما. The shuyukh they narrated from. Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Farabi. Are you there, brothers? That's important for you to note that down. And Dhahabi's statement that he said that he didn't hear from him is actually wrong. It's actually what? Wrong. Because when did... what year was he? Farabri born? 231, right? When did Qutaybah ibn Sa'id die? He died. What year was he born? 231. Qutaybah ibn Sa'id died 240. How old would he be?
Nine.
He could have met him. No, no, no. How many, what did you say? Qutaybah ibn Sa'id. So, how much? When did I say this? When did he die?
231.
231. Okay. And when did Farabri, when did Qutaybah ibn Sa'id die? Qutaybah is not written for me. I'm sure Qutaybah died 240. Did I mention Qutaybah ibn Sa'id? No. Al-Baghlani. Nine is enough for us to say to somebody met somebody. Hatta wa in kana. Or if we round it to 10. Bukhari, he was narrating at what age? Are you with me, brothers? Even if he hears one hadith from him, one hadith. So Qutaybah ibn Sa'id heard it from him. This is where Dhahabi did istib'ad of it. That's not istib'ad. Hatta even if we say, okay, Qutaybah, we'll take it, we'll say no to it. What about Ali ibn Khashram, who no one's disputing? That's from the shuyukh of Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim. Are you there, brothers? Ala kulli hal, Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Farabri is a student of the shaykh of al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim. Also, al-Imam Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Farabri, people travel to take from him large in number. Are you with me, brothers? If a person is weak, muttahamun bil kadhib, people will stay away from him, right? Not to mention, Muhammad ibn Yusuf ibn Matar al-Farabri actually had a copy of Bukhari. The one that the author himself wrote, he had it. So even if, let's say he was weak, people were seeing it from the what? Are you there, brothers? Another thing I personally believe can close the whole discussion and everything can be settled here. Every single hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari is found in other books of hadith. Every hadith that's in Sahih al-Bukhari is found in other books of hadith. Are you there, brothers? Don't let anybody lie and deceive the ummah by saying that when Bukhari Sahih goes, it's found in Musannaf Nabi Shayba and it's found in... Should we take those ones down as well? Walidalika, something very, very fascinating I took from my sheikh, which was what Shaykh Abdul Muhsin Abbad. He said something very powerful in his Salaf Sunan Abi Dawood. Shaykh Abdul Muhsin Abbad said the books of hadith that were lost, they did not have information that we don't need. It's a powerful point. Because how do we know that? We actually found some books that we thought were lost. When we found them, they had the information we already had. Allah says, وَإِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا ذِكْرًا وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. Allah is going to protect you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That every single books that we've lost do not bring us additional rulings that are missing from us. Don't think to yourself, بَقِيَةَ مِنْ مَخْلَةِ مُسْنَدِ. If we found it today, we're going to learn things that were haram, that Allah, we were eating all this time. No, never. Okay, we'll stop inshallah.